the third Sunday after Epiphany, and our theme for today is true faith and true authority. And our chief thought of the day then is how the Lord manifests his divine mercy by performing the two miracles which we read about in our gospel lesson today. We begin with our first hymn.
Thank you.
beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. God, mercifully look upon our infirmities and in all our dangers and necessities stretch forth the right hand of your majesty to help and defend us through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, true God, now and forever. Before the chief thought of the day is the Lord manifesting his divine glory. The Lord came down from the mountain and met the anguish, the hearts of men who were in misery of life, the stern realities they faced as sinful humanity, and Christ, the promised one, has come. He showed his divine mercy when the blind received their sight. When the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have the good news preached to them. In our first lesson, although Israel was still in captivity, and Jeremiah the prophet was under arrest, this is the second time that God spoke to the prophet, that the Lord was determined to do as he promised. And God invites them to search out his great love. Our first lesson is from the Old Testament reading of Jeremiah 33, verses 6 through 9. Behold, I will bring it healing, our health and healing. I will heal them and reveal to them the abundance of peace and truth. And I will cause the captives of Judah and the captives of Israel to return, and will build those places as at the first. I will cleanse them from all their iniquities by which they have sinned against me, and I will pardon all their iniquities by which they have sinned and by which they have transgressed against me. Then it shall be to me a name of joy, a praise, and an honor before all nations of the earth, who shall hear all the good that I do to them. They shall fear and tremble for all goodness and all the prosperity that I provide for it. Here endeth our first reading. And we join in our reading of the confessional reading that is printed in the bulletin. This time it is from the Apology of the Augsburg Confession, Part 9, Baptism. They approve the 9th article, where we confess that baptism is necessary for salvation. Children are to be baptized. The baptism of children is not useless, but is necessary and efficacious for salvation. Among us, the gospel is taught purely and diligently. It is most certain that the promise of salvation also applies to little children. It does not apply to those who are outside of Christ's church, where there is neither word nor sacrament, because Christ regenerates through word and sacrament. Therefore, it is necessary to baptize children so that the promise of salvation might be applied to them according to Christ's command. Baptize all nations, just as their salvation is offered to all, so baptism is offered to all, men, women, children, and infants. Therefore, it clearly follows that infants should be baptized, because salvation is offered in baptism. In the lesson for the Epistle, it is the concluding portion of this chapter where St. Paul shows plainly what is meant by infirmities, dangers, and necessities, and how great is our need for God's right hand of help to defend us. The epistle lesson for the third Sunday after Epiphany is written in the book of Romans, chapter 12, verses 17 through 21. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, "It is mine who avenge, I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Here endeth our epistle, and we join in the gratitude. Alleluia. Oh, praise the Lord, all you nations. Laud him, all you peoples. For his merciful kindness is great towards us, and the truth of the Lord endures forever.
Came down from heaven incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated for our next hymn.
Thank you.
have faith in you to both hear and answer our prayers. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Epiphany is a season, is all about Jesus revealing his divinity through the veil of his human nature by means of miracles. Our text from the 8th chapter of Matthew has two miracles. Jesus cleanses the leper. From verses 2 and 3 we read, "A man with leprosy came and knelt before him and said, 'Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean.' Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. 'I am willing,' he said, 'be clean.' Immediately he was cured of his leprosy. And he also healed the servant of the centurion from a distance, simply by willing it to be so." We read verses 5 through 8. "When Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him asking for help. 'Lord,' he said, 'my servant lies at home paralyzed and in terrible pain.' Jesus said to him, 'I will go and heal him.' The centurion replied, 'Lord, I do not deserve to have you come under my roof, but just say the word, and my servant will be healed. O Lord, sanctify us by your truth. Your word is truth. Amen.'" So our focus this morning then is what precedes both of these healings: a plain yet powerful confession of faith. In both confessions, the authority of Jesus to do what was desired was also clearly confessed. So this morning, with the help of the Holy Spirit, we consider our theme, true faith and true authority. Dear fellow redeemed, leprosy was in those days a very frightening disease. Lepers were forced to keep their distance from regular people and to call out a warning, "Unclean," if anyone approached them. When the Jews called this uncleanness, they did not mean dirty, although many of them probably did not do very well on keeping clean. But it was this skin decay, or this contagious, very contagious disease. Leprosy today is contagious, but only prior to treatment. However, in the Bible times, there was no effective treatment. Leprosy was then applied to many of the Bible names for various diseases. It could be even carried in their fabric of their clothing, or even in the walls of the house. It started as a skin condition that caused disfigurement, nerve damage, and deterioration of the infected body part, even to the point of destroying them. And the only effective way they had to limit its spread was to isolate the victims of the disease, to destroy their clothing, and often even the buildings they lived in. The leper in our gospel broke all these rules of isolation. He approached Jesus. He stated simply that if Jesus desired to, he could cleanse the man of his leprosy. That was a bold statement, a bold confession, for in those days anyone would tell you that only God could cure a leper. No one else could even or would even touch this person for fear of being infected. But Jesus touched the man, and instead of being made unclean by this disease, Jesus made this man clean by his touch. He said, "I am willing, be cleansed." And immediately the man was cleansed of his leprosy. Jesus then told the man to tell no one, not to make a public issue of this healing, for he did not want followers just because he could heal them. Instead, Jesus told the man to go to the temple, show yourselves to the priests as prescribed by law, and then give a sacrifice as prescribed in scriptures for the one who was cleansed of leprosy. In short, Jesus wanted the man to give thanks to God and to give glory to his healing to God and to recognize where his blessings had come from. The man showed his faith, Jesus demonstrated his authority, and to command this disease and to heal him. Now the second healing involved the centurion. Now this centurion was a good and honest man. And you can see this in what he does. For he demonstrates such a concern about his servant who was paralyzed in pain. Secondly, this Roman, or he was a Roman and not a Jew. And then he comes to a Jew for help. Clearly, he must have heard about Jesus, believed that Jesus had the ability to heal. Clearly, this man had believed that Jesus had come to the world to save sinners, to heal this man. Yet the centurion declines when Jesus said he would come because he didn't want to trouble Jesus and he feels unworthy for him to come to his house. He tells Jesus that he knows Jesus does not need to come to do the healing. The centurion believes Jesus has authority. And being a man under authority himself, he understands how authority works. He tells Jesus he only needs to say the word and his servant will be healed. He then compares the authority of Jesus over this paralysis and the troubles of this servant to military having authority over him. And he believes Jesus possesses this authority, and he was right. Jesus then marvels at the faith of this Gentile. He proclaims that he hasn't found such faith in all of Israel, which then prompts him to speak about the future, about the kingdom of God. He tells the Jews that many will come from the east and the west and will recline with Abraham, that is, will go to heaven. But the son of the kingdom, the Jews, who rejected and cast, will be cast out in utter darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth as he describes the bitter sorrow and the deep regret of eternal damnation in hell. Many Jews will be on the outside, but many Gentiles all over the world will enter into heaven. It is a certain contrast to the popular theology and the popular religion of the Jews, but it was opposed to what Scripture taught. But what Jesus said was true, and we see that reality described for us today. In fact, the Christian church is primarily made up of Gentiles. And the Jews still, to this day, hold hostility towards Christ and to Christians. Our gospel lesson now speaks about Jesus' power to intervene in all our troubles and in our illnesses. It is what the centurion refers to as authority. And our text shows us just how willing Jesus is to heal and to bless. It pictures for us graphically how bold and unexpected his help was after all. He touched this leper. There is nothing that God will not do if it is his will to do that at that moment. And when God speaks, all creation of the world obeys. We are sinful men and women. We often do not listen. We willfully ignore him. He could force us to obey by his power, as he did the disease of leprosy or the paralysis and pain of the servant of the centurion. But he doesn't do that to us. We have free will. Yet these men understood who Jesus really was. And sin is the source of all our trouble. They knew that it was in the hands of the Savior to rescue, and that it was the nature of the Savior to heal and save. That is true faith. It is faith that says that when Jesus commands it, it cannot fail to be accomplished. His nature and power is the same today. In all of our troubles, our Lord can and will help. James talks about this when speaking about prayer. He says that we do not have because we do not ask. And he goes on to say that even when we ask, we often do not receive because we ask from the wrong motives. We ask just for ourselves. We ask for our comfort, for our own pleasure. That is why when we fail to pray, or when our prayers seem to fail when we do pray, our sins of unbelief stand in the way. The centurion came to full confidence of the nature of Jesus and the authority of Jesus. And when we cry out to God, we also need to do so knowing who Jesus is and who we are before him. We need to come with the right motives, submitting ourselves in humility to the will of God and to the plan that God has for us in our lives. We need to acknowledge his authority, to believe in him, and to trust his will for our own salvation. When we pray in accordance with the will of God, God answers every prayer with a resounding yes. And if we call upon him in faith and not with timidness or doubting heart, God gives us what we need and what his will strives to accomplish. We need a faith like the centurion that is, nothing is too distant. Nothing too large or small, or nothing can stand in the way of God. He will speak, and it will be done. Isn't that a wonderful comfort? Isn't that wonderful hope for us as we continue our lives here in this simple world? Because we've sinned and continue to sin, we need to trust in God and call upon him. God loves us. He sent his only son to die for us. And we need to trust God and call upon him. God loves us. He sent that son to pay for our sins, to purchase us, and to purchase and win us over sin and death. And he has called us to true faith. He has called us and given us a name in baptism, and has appointed us to be among those who he spoke of in our text, from among the many who had come from the east and the west and reclined with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. And he is here on our altar. He has set a table before you and me with his true body and blood for us to partake of and receive full forgiveness for all our sins. Today, many churches celebrate the Right to Life Sunday. The readings today have spoken to us about God's will for our lives. He gives us the will to live. It is given as a gift freely from God through the means of grace. God would have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of truth. He cleansed the leper. He healed the servant of the centurion. And he has called us to everlasting life in glory with him, because that is his will and what it is like. Our God is the source of life, and in all issues of life and death belong in his hands. That is why we are profoundly pro-life. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." How can then those who worship him be anything but pro-life? But for many, this issue of pro-life or pro-abortion has largely fallen off our news media. And frankly, many of us have no real interest in hearing about it or knowing about it. We have a struggling economy at times. Many are against our new president and are protesting. And countless other scandals command the news media's attention. But what happens when a shooting comes across the news? The issues then of the value of true life smacks us right back into focus. So what is the value of life? When these things happen, we all agree that there is some wrong or evil, that someone's life should not be taken away from them, but no more so than the deaths of those who die in legal abortions. Do you realize that 625,000 in Minnesota alone and 57.5 million babies have been killed since 1973? That's an average of one abortion every 26 seconds, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week in this country alone. And we should not be concerned only about the physical life of that poor little baby, but also their eternal salvation. The victims of abortion have been put to death before the word of God could be spoken to them, before the sacrament of baptism could be administered. And scripture tells us that they are all like us, conceived in sin. And abortion is not the only issue before us today, is it? We continue to hear increasing questions about euthanasia, mercy killing, assisted suicide. And now, whether we know it or not, our health care systems and our health care-driven issues have set death, or the will to cause a death, before the issue of life. Like the centurion, we too are men and women under authority. We are under the authority of our Lord first, and then our state second. We ought to obey God rather than man. And I don't mean you need to be out manning a picket line someplace. Or I don't want you to be one of these infamous abortion of protesters who break the law, make the news, and give other pro-life people a bad name. We want to be citizens who avail themselves to our rights and authorities. We can write letters to our Congress. We can make calls. We can offer to man an abortion hotline or a pregnancy hotline. Or we can help out at one of the many pregnancy centers. And if you desire, you could give money to places like Minnesota Concern for Life, Lutherans for Life, or other pro-life organizations. The world needs help to understand the issues of life, and that we need to stand clearly upon them ourselves. Most of all, we need to pray for those people who do not understand that life is in God's hands. God will hear. God will answer. God will bless if we simply trust Him, in Him, and call upon Him. And God shows how much He clearly cared as He responded to this leper. He has the authority. Back in Bible times, leprosy seemed impossible to cure and paralysis incurable, but Jesus was able to handle both of them. The troubles in our lives are like the problems addressed in the gospel today, and when our Lord speaks, they will obey. And all we need to remember is this: that God can and will help, and we need to trust that He will bless and help us. So we call upon Him in every need. Yes, it is our turn to exercise our faith, and our Lord will exercise His authority. Amen. Please rise for the blessing. And now may the peace of God, which passes all our understanding, keep our hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, by your Holy Spirit, give us the vision to see the needs of your heavenly kingdom, to give us hearts so filled with thankfulness that we will generously give and deliberately labor to fulfill them. Accept this offering which we lay before you. Use it for that great work of preparing pastors and teachers for the ministry of the word and for the supporting of your servants who now speak the divine message of love and redemption. Amen. Today we will have a sanctity of life prayer as we notice the anniversary of when Roe versus Wade was put into effect. We hear God's guidance then in the word of 2 Corinthians or Chronicles 7:14. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sins and heal their land. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the eternal God who came to this fallen world to redeem a people for yourselves. Through your blood shed at Calvary, we have the promise of eternal life and the forgiveness of our sins and the hope in the world to come. We, your people, confess the sins of our nation concerning abortion of children. Your word tells us that righteousness exalts a nation, but that sin is a reproach to any people. We have shed the blood of the innocent. We have soaked our nation's soil with the blood of innocent people. We confess that all too often we as a nation have been indifferent to the plight of the unborn child. We have preferred to go our own way rather than become involved in speaking up for those who cannot speak up for themselves. This is often shown in our attitude of selfishness. We confess the sin of our leaders who have legalized this evil, and the mass media who has promoted this evil as good, and of those people that support abortion who use the desperateness and ignorance of people as a way of making money. We confess our sins as your people in this matter. We have not prayed as much as we ought. We have not spoken up in private and in public as we ought. We have not shown the love and the compassion to desperate mothers as we ought. And we have not at times used our money or time or labor to establish alternatives as we ought to. And we may have not taught our own people or our families or children about this subject. Forgive your people their many sins and failures. You alone give us hope and righteousness. Teach us to be concerned about the right to life of an unborn child. Enable us to humbly seek your face and your will and to be moved by your obedience out of love for you and turn helplessly to you. Forgive our nation for tolerating this vice and their callous indifference to the sanctity of life. Grant conviction to all of us who have sinned in this matter of abortion one way or another. Bless health workers who have sought to do your will in refusing to have any part of murder of an unborn child, who have sacrificed maybe careers and opportunities for doing what is right rather than not. Encourage them with the love and support of your church, the teaching of your word, and the presence of your Holy Spirit. Draw near to those women who out of ignorance or desperation have aborted their children. Move them to repentance, the peace of your forgiveness, and the fellowship of your church. Heal their hearts, minds, and bodies. Restore them to wholeness and hope. And Holy Father, in whose hands and in whose time all people everywhere and of every age hear from heaven your dwelling place and forgive us all our sins, heal our land, we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated, and I now ask our church council to come forward for their installation of officers. Dear friends in Christ, in holy baptism, the Lord Jesus Christ liberated you from sin and death and made you members of his body, the church. Through word and sacrament, we have been nurtured in faith. We have been selected at 4 positions of leadership to serve the Lord on behalf of this congregation. The Lord has entrusted you with an office that you are to carry out as his servants and according to his will. Paul writes concerning service in the church, "We have different gifts according to grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, then let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do so cheerfully. But one thing the Lord seeks among all those who serve is faithfulness. The Lord does not seek from us what he has not given us, but when he does give us a gift, his will is to use it to faithfully to his glory for the benefit of his people and his church. You as servants of Jesus Christ, workers in this congregation, are to set an example of Christian life for your families and for the whole church. Make God's word your foundation and guide. Search it daily for comfort and instruction, and keep us all in your prayers. And so that the congregation may be assured of your willingness to serve and the promise you have made to serve, I ask you in the presence of God and this congregation, will you diligently and faithfully carry out the office entrusted to you according to the ability that God gives you? Then answer, I will, and ask God to help me. President Keith Peterson, Vice President Kevin Lenutka, Secretary Mari Wobaum, Treasurer for a 3-year term, James Gottenberg, and Brad Bachman, Elder, Cemetery Board, James Gottenberg, Nominating Committee, Baxter Bachman, Head Usher, James Gottenberg, Evangelist Committee, Harvey Gruntz, Keith Peterson, and then Sunday School Superintendent for a year, Marty Wobaum. I now install you as officers of Emmanuel Lutheran Church in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. May the Lord guide and direct you by his Holy Spirit. May he strengthen and help you in every way so that you are able to fulfill your duties with complete faithfulness. And let us pray. Merciful and gracious God, our lives are open before you and you hear our promises. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit into the hearts of these your servants, that they may carry out their duties with diligence, boldness, and wisdom. Give them a spirit of devotion and prayer, that in every time of need they may present their requests to you. Enable them to set an example by doing what is good, that by their lives they may build up your congregation and give the enemies of your church no cause for complaint. Make them a blessing to your believers. Help them work with their pastor and with one another, and grant that by their service the unity of this congregation may be strengthened, your name be hallowed, your kingdom enlarged, and your will be done. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. We now together ask God's blessing on the church council. Go in peace. Give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that in your labor, the Lord is not in vain. The Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. You may return to your seats and we continue with our next hymn.
Lord,
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and everlasting God. And now do we praise thee that thou didst send unto us thy only begotten Son, and that in him, being found in the fashion as a man, thou didst manifest the fullness of thy glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Please rise as we continue with the Nunc Dimittis on page 29. Thank you.
fellowship in college. Please stay for that, if you can. This week we have Tuesday, the women's sewing group. Please come for that. And also then Wednesday, confirmation. We have a test, so please note that there will not be Bible study, as you see down below. I will be in Mankato visiting family part of this week. We'll be back on Friday, so phone number for all of the elders. Next week, then, we do have our regular schedule with confirmation examination, coffee and fellowship, and then our youth group. If you haven't received your directory yet, please pick one up. They're in a box in my office, or see Lorena. She can find one for you quick. Please note that. And then I know there were some people that asked for extra ones. I think that's no problem. There's over 20-some still in the box, I see. So please note that. Coffee sign-up sheet there. It looks different around here when you take the Christmas decorations down. It's kind of empty. You know, there's more room. It's like, wow. Anyway, we look forward to Lent, and we can put up different decorations, right? As far as any other announcements, is there anything else that anybody has? Notice the ICW is holding a grocery drive. Keep that in mind. Nothing else, then may God's richest blessings go with you throughout the week.